Here we are checking in once again with Sean Wheelock, who once again was limited a little bit in how much time he's able to do the commentary here for Skyblue FC game in Philadelphia. But we're just going to check in and talk a little bit more Bellator with Sean. Season 3 underway now. How's everything been going as far as getting everything kicked back off?
Yeah, it's great. It's amazing to be back. It was only a 6-week break, I think, but it felt like about a 600-week break. I knew how much I loved that show. But being away from it told me that I love that show even more than I thought. It's the best gig by far of my career. Come back to really, really strong shows. We had some very decisive finishes at the Hard Rock in Hollywood, Florida, and we had some decisions in our last show in Chicago, but take nothing away with some of those fights. I know our audience, they weren't delighted with the Cole Conrad-Rojan Uret fight, but you know what? Cole Conrad keeps winning. He's fought 3 times in Bellator, including most recently in our tournament. He's had 3 decisions, so it's about a total of 45 minutes, but he keeps winning, and it's tough to find fault with someone who not only keeps winning, but never finds themselves in trouble. And Rojan Uret, who we beat in the opening round of our heavyweight tournament, I had Rojan, I believe, 5 different fights when I announced for M1. Rojan is a dangerous man. He's a 250-pound Brazilian jiu-jitsu black belt, and Cole Conrad really neutralized Rojan Uret. And the Dan Hornbuckle fight against Brad Blackburn was fantastic on our last show. I was really, really happy to see that. So I couldn't be more excited. You know, we've got some real, real stars in the making. I mean, someone like Megumi Fuchihi is a legitimate star in Japan, and I think she's maybe 2 wins away from being a really serious MMA star here in the U.S.
And just as a side note, we'd like to apologize to any of the people viewing in here if the audio is a little loud in the background. We are actually out here at halftime, so of course the DJ's pumping in a little bit. But definitely can agree with you though, Sean, with the layoff. I think I watched the last Kansas City show on replay probably about 6 or 7 times just to kind of get my feel to be ready. But one person in particular I'd like to bring up, who I'm not even sure, honestly, if he is a person or a machine or what he is, but that would be Hector Lombard, who is absolutely a specimen, first of all. But can you just talk a little bit about just how good he truly is?
Oh, he's fantastic. And, you know, Hector Lombard looks massive on television. Then you see him in person. He's not a massive 185-pounder. I don't know what we list Hector. I think he's probably 5'8.5", 5'9". Incredibly muscular. I can see from your reaction you're surprised by that because he looks so much bigger. He's incredibly muscular, obviously, through his arms and his shoulders, and so much of that is just his God-given physique. Also, he works so hard. And then, of course, he played judo for Cuba at the 2000 Olympics, which I think a lot of people forget that he's a judo black belt and judo Olympian because of his knockout power. But Hector is such a complex, interesting, fascinating person, and he really stresses that, you know, to him, champions aren't born. He says champions are made in the gym, and Hector Lombard will downplay whatever natural ability he has. He'll tell you that he is where he is in this sport because he believes that he outworks people. When you look at his results, it's difficult to go against that. My question about Hector Lombard, and I normally don't play on the rankings, and they are what they are, and I don't want to sound like a shill for Bellator or fighters, but when I look at the SB USA Today rankings, and Hector is not in the top 10 of 185 pounders, that to me is shocking. Over 20 victories, he's lost. He's our Bellator World Middleweight Champion. Even if they want to look past that, he's lost 2 fights in his pro career. Both were in 2006, both were by decision, and both were in Pride. Akihiro Gono and Gegard Mousasi. So that's the one fighter I look in the rankings where I wonder, what more does he have to do to get in? And maybe if he can get a win versus Alexander Shlemenko, who is not in top 10 in SB USA Today, maybe that gets Hector Lombard in. But you probably can't worry too much about the rankings, and Hector Lombard really doesn't care about the rankings.
Doesn't look like he cares about too much except running through his opposition. But as you were talking about before, Sean, Season 3 is now underway, and the heavyweight tournament and the women's tournament are both underway right now as well. How would you feel each of those is going right now?
Yeah, really, really good, and we've had 3 of our 4 heavyweight fights now. One coming up on our show this upcoming Thursday in Kansas City at the Power and Light District is Alexei Olenek, another very, very good European fighter who I know quite well from M1. I think I've done 4 or 5, maybe even 6 of Olenek's fights over the last few years in M1, against Mike Hayes. And Mike Hayes is an underrated American heavyweight. That's an interesting fight. Neil Grove looked absolutely dominant. You know, I think we all know how good and how talented Eddie Sanchez is and can be, especially on a night, and it wasn't his night. Neil Grove, I look at him, that's the one heavyweight in our tournament who can physically compete with Cole Conrad, because Neil Grove is 6'6", Cole Conrad, I believe, is 6'4". Cole Conrad's been cutting down his weight to walk around at about 270 pounds. Neil Grove told me that he cut down from 290 for that fight. Two obviously very different fighters, but that's an intriguing matchup. I don't know if we'll see it in the semis. I don't know if we'll see it in the finals. I don't know if we'll see it at all, but that's really intriguing to me. And don't discount Alexei Oleinik. Unless you followed M1, you probably don't know a lot about him, but he's rated really, after Fedor Emelianenko, maybe somewhere equal to or just a little behind Alexander Emelianenko, is one of the top, certainly one of the top three heavyweights out of Russia. And I think a lot of people make the case that he's maybe a little better than Alexander Emelianenko. He's a pretty special fighter. In terms of the women's tournament, it's amazing to me that Bjorn Rebny was able to put together that field where you have all of these top-ranked women's fighters coming together in one tournament. Megumi Fujii is now 21-0 in her pro career. And just on the show last week when we had Jessica Penne, 7-0, top 10 ranked in the world, and she loses to Zoila Frosto. Whoever wins that tournament definitely has a claim as being the top pound-for-pound female fighter in the world. And obviously, Christiane Cyborg Santos has her fans, and Gina Carano has her fans, but it would be tough to discount whoever wins that tournament is not being the best women's 115-pound, obviously, but the best pound-for-pound women's fighter in the world.
And now, one last thing I want to touch on you with, Sean. Interesting, a dynamic that really makes mixed martial arts more entertaining is not only having, you know, people educated that are commentating and, you know, can explain to, you know, the casual fan that might be able to convert into being an MMA fan, but also the dynamic that you have with your partner. Now, of course, you and Jimmy Smith have got quite an experience or in a past, have a past together. Now, how important is that dynamic to you as someone who's been doing this a long time?
Yeah, you know, I get a lot of comments, like people say, yeah, I really can tell that you guys are friends, and Jimmy and I are legitimately friends. You know, we speak on the phone, we're friends with each other's families. Jimmy has a fantastic girlfriend who's a television producer for A&E, and Sandra was down at our Fort Lauderdale or Hollywood, Florida show. Jimmy knows my wife, Kelly, knows my little girl, Ellie. We're genuinely friends. There's a lot of, not necessarily in MMA, but just in sports broadcasting, there's a lot of maybe fake friendships where you think the commentators are buddy-buddy because they work together every week, and the reality is they're not. It's just an office colleague. Jimmy and I are legitimately friends, and with M1, we had the chance to literally travel around the world together and be in these countries for 6, 7, 8 days, and Jimmy's a fantastic guy. He's one of the nicest people I've ever met, and it's fun. When we roll, he's discounted as a fighter, because most people know him from Fight Quest, or maybe from M1, or now from Bellator. But Jimmy is a very, very talented fighter. He's been inactive for a while as he's been focusing on his television career. But when we roll, you see just how strong and how powerful and explosive and skillful Jimmy is. And I'm glad that it shows. I'm glad that people can tell that we like each other. What's amazing to me, you know, I've been doing this since I was 18 years old, working in broadcasting. Jimmy, before he got chosen from an open casting call for Fight Quest, had never done television. And he sounds like somebody who's been doing television literally all of their lives. He's incredibly talented. And if you just look at the little things that he does on a broadcast, and you hear how composed he is and the intelligent points he makes, you know, I think you'll agree that he has to rank with the elite color commentators in the sport. Personally, I think that he's the best. Everyone has their own fans, but it's tough to say a bad word about him because I don't think he can.
Definitely a fan of what you guys got going on there. But I guess, Sean, I hear the bells rattling, and it sounds like the players getting back out in the field. Going to switch back over into the press box and take care of things there, but I definitely want to thank you for spending a few minutes with us and coming out to New Jersey.
Anytime. Thank you so much. Thanks for the coverage and the support.
All right. Thanks, Sean.